Let's turn now from the theoretical justifications of paleo to its purported health benefits. Cordain's book contains a section that is de rigueur in diet books. A contrast is drawn between the proposed diet and the current disastrous eating habits of a lot of us in the United States. The problem with this comparison is that these awful diets, justified by cost, cravings, and convenience, are not planned for their nutritional benefits, and no one claims they are healthy, although hamburgers might find defenders among the low-carbers if the bun is removed. Yes, Cordain is right that some of us are failing nutritionally. Practically any reasonable planned diet, and even some unreasonable ones like paleo, will probably compare well to a junk food diet. Comparing your diet to a diet composed of cheap, fatty, highly marketed industrialized foods is just like shooting fish in a barrel. Cordain shows his lack of confidence in his own diet by choosing to compare it to an imaginary nightmarish incarnation of the junk food diet, which includes a Danish for breakfast with coffee and sugar. To make sure the cornflakes look bad, he adds extra sugar to them too. He wants you to remember, as you read about this slow-motion suicide diet, that the USDA wants you to eat lots of grains, implying that Danish is what they have in mind. To be fair to Cordain, other grains consumed in this imaginary day come in the form of a glazed donut, a cheese pizza, and yes, a hamburger bun. Somehow this imaginary worst-case scenario diet mustered 8 grams of fiber. I guess this is what it takes to make paleo look good in its creator's mind. Cordain actually asserts, many nutritionists would say the example diet is healthful because it contains large amounts of carbohydrates. Dr. Cordain, can you name a single professional nutritionist who would call a diet with only 8 grams of fiber healthful? With this absurd statement, Cordain demonstrates his total insincerity in matters of public health. The average American is only consuming 12 to 18 grams of fiber, so even for the nutritionally oblivious, Cordain's comparison diet is pathetic. Cordain has his paleo diet reach 47 grams of fiber, and this indeed is one of its better features. It is unimpressive, however, when compared to examples of past populations. Here it is stated that hunter-gatherers had diets that were mainly fiber. This researcher asserts that fiber often exceeded 100 grams per day. At his Paleobiotics website, he relates the enormous quantities of fiber that prehistoric peoples have been estimated to have consumed, along with the amazing variety of plants they enjoyed. Funnily enough, the paleo diet proposed by Cordain's primitive nutrition partner Boyd Eaton in 1988 had 150 grams of fiber, well in line with these references. So why is Cordain so impressed with his 47 grams? I should mention that there are people out there who say high fiber consumption is harmful. If you encounter advice along these lines, a little skepticism might be in order. It seems to me the primitive nutrition promoters engage in some obvious motivated reasoning to justify their beliefs. Here is a scholarly article Cordain wrote to construct a tenuous argument against grains. He seems concerned about the ill effects experienced by bakers who inhale flour. What if he applied a similar standard to meat? A litany of cancers are linked to workers in poultry plants. Recall that in a previous video, I showed you that zoonotic diseases increased with the advent of agriculture as animals were domesticated. This study demonstrates the cancer-causing effects of zoonotic virus infections passed from animal to man. These viruses are likely some of the same that cause butcher's warts. There is also a paralyzing illness caused by contact with aerosolized pig brains. Occupational exposure to meat is linked to lung cancer. When you read Cordain's concerns about baker's asthma, you should bear in mind that there is a range of illnesses associated with breathing things you should not breathe. Flour can contaminate the lungs if you breathe enough of it, just like any other airborne debris. The serious risks to those who process meats make particles of flour seem rather innocent by comparison, but Cordain doesn't seem concerned about those. Cordain likes to point to a handful of human diet studies that he thinks prove how great paleo is. In the next video, I'll show you those. They are disappointing, to put it mildly.